Hey guys, Dave Lalonek. So this video is part 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 maybe of the McLaren coolant leak saga. What a challenge. So last night I changed a clamp that was my 8th hose clamp that I found leaks on. 8. It's kind of actually 8.5. The lower radiator hose, I had already changed to a constant tension clamp. One goes to the block, to the passenger side radiator. And for no reason I can understand, I had a leak there as well. And it doesn't make any sense. I just repositioned the clamp and it seems to be good. So the 8th hose clamp is a hose that goes from the bottom of the expansion tank to an aluminum tube on the mounted on top of the chassis or the frame rail, and that was leaking. And I took care of that. I pressure tested the car last night about 7:30, 8 o'clock, something like that, 15 psi, one bar, and it held. When I got up this morning, it was held, and I just got home a while ago, it held. So about 22 hours it held, so I'm calling that a win. And that's the best pressure test I had through all this. I mean, it's the only one that held 100%. I had ones that drifted a little, so I feel pretty good, but this is on a cold car. So when I heat the car up, what's gonna change? I don't know, but again, 8 hose clamps I changed. So this video is a series of everything I've done from that point to now. Now, there was a period when in the beginning of the summer that I got the car out. I drove it about 1,000 miles, still had a leak. I kept topping off the coolant each drive. I'd put about a coffee cup in every 100 miles or so. And then it progressively got a little worse. I started finding, you know, other leaks. So I put the car back on the lift a couple of weeks ago, and I've been working on this. I was out of town for a little while. But in any event, the video is not a DIY what to do. The video is a compilation of everything I've gone through since the start of having this leak to where I am today. So I started working on it in the winter, and then I resumed early spring. And again, it's been, I think, 3 times on and off the lift, you know, chasing down these leaks. We're gonna see when I get it back together if I actually solve the problem and its history. If 8 clamps went bad, more likely 2 go bad, you know, at some point, hopefully not the rest of the season. So again, the video is information to help people. Maybe you could pick up tips. Maybe you can see different things. It's not a step-by-step, you know, this is what I did to do like an oil change or anything like that. It's just a compilation of all the crap I've been through and what I did, the different clamps I used, using the endoscope to find things. Things of that nature. I did not put leak stop in the coolant. Didn't want to do that on a supercar motor. So there's none of that. I suspect that a lot of McLarens have it in because some of these are tiny leaks. But in any event, once again, enjoy the video. Comment below. I'm just going to put everything together as a compilation. And I'll put a comment in about a few days and let you know if it is fully resolved. Okay? Thanks for watching, guys. Enjoy. And any questions, let me know. Thanks. Okay, so I got the whole side body scoop and everything removed to get access to the radiator. Here's where the fun begins. You're out here to access that hose, which is, that hose is right about there somewhere. It would be cool if there was a panel right here, but there ain't. So, yeah, that's the next project. So I am idling the car right now. I've been running about 15 minutes, and I'm washing the Maserati in between. But, you know, here's my suspect area, and there's no coolant leak yet. Again, it may happen at shutdown. But what I'll do, too, I'm going to just let it idle for a little bit, and then I'll hop in and I'll rev it up a bit to heat it up a little bit more. And then, you know, once I shut it down, I'll get the endoscope in there too and see if that hose is wet.
Hey
Hey guys, Dave here. So after quite some time, I'm back at the McLaren looking to fix that coolant leak. And I believe I left off the last video where I had the whole side of the car off here. So I'm considering some options of attack right now. Essentially, the camera's probably not gonna show it, but I've showed it in the prior video. It's not that main hose, it's the hose behind it, smaller hose. And what I'm gonna do is remove the factory clamp and then put on a constant force clamp. So I'm considering my options right now. I can get my hand in there barely and touch it by reaching around that other hose. But what I'm looking at doing now is possibly removing this air duct to afford me some room to get in there. So I'm gonna probably take off these bolts for this that bracket and see what kind of wiggle room I've got. Of course, I do see a bolt right on top of the frame there too, right up in here. That's probably not gonna be all that easy to get to. But I'm gonna see what it possibly takes to do that. My other option is to take off the brackets for the radiator here and then down below here and lower down the radiator and hope that I can get my hand up in here to do that. Of course, I've got the condenser here, which isn't awesome, but I'm gonna see what kind of works and I'll try to video what I can, but obviously my priority right now is trying to get the job done. And I don't know if I have access to set a camera up and film appropriately while I do this. So stay tuned. I'm studying the manual here. Now, you know, this is all off of 3D models, but I'm very familiar with all this right now because I've been looking at it for a while. So this is a bracket that mounts to the subframe, and there's some bolts here that are very accessible. And then there's another bracket. They show up a blow up here because the bolts are kind of underneath, but you can access them no problem. So they're saying first step is to detach the lower hose clamp and hose. All right, so that's the step I want to avoid. I want to see if I can drop this thing, if there's any slack. Now, remember, I'm not removing the radiator. I just want to get access to that hose. So I'm going to skip that step and then follow the steps that follow. So this photo is from like if you're seeing through the car or looking top down. So this is the hose I gotta get at. Okay, so that's the main hose. This is the, I don't know if they call it the bypass hose, I think. So that's number 9 is the clamp, 10 is the hose. That's the connection I gotta get at. So clearly when you lower the radiator, you can get to it, and that's the kicker. So I need to see if I can, you know, lower the radiator with it connected and have enough slack in the lower hose to do that. If not, I gotta drain the system, no big deal. So I think I'm going at this weekend. I want this car done. But number 5 here is a couple of bolts that have a bracket that go to the fan. I didn't see those until tonight, but they're there. I actually thought there was just one, but there's not, there's 2. Those are gonna be a little bit of a pisser to get to, but I'll be able to get to them. So anyway, that's the plan. That's what I'm gonna do. I tried seeing if I could sneak my hand in by going through, there's a ductway. I made a video, I'll show you, but I don't think I can get in. I think the radiator's gotta come down. I'm gonna try to drop the radiator a couple inches to be able to reach my hand up above the radiator from the top side and disconnect the clamp, change the clamp, and reconnect it. Now I'm gonna try to do this without draining any of the fluid. Good luck, right? And I'm also gonna try to do it without messing with the condenser and the dryer filter here. I'm not sure it's gonna work out. So we've got a bracket here on the subframe. Those bolts have to come out. There's another bracket underneath here, a couple of bolts. I already clipped a couple of zip ties off of this. And then there's a bracket that goes to like to the top of the fan. You can see it there, it's got some bolts. So I'm gonna get started and start pulling these bolts out in the hopes that I can lower this radiator a couple inches to access the top. If that doesn't work, the next plan of attack will be to drain the system and remove the lower radiator hose. I'm really hoping that I don't have to mess with the AC system, but if I gotta do it, I gotta do it. So we'll see what happens here.
So I got the bolts out of the first bracket and I actually pulled it right from the radiator. There's some rubber grommets there. And I got that out of the way so that also it affords me a little bit of room with the condenser lines. Of course, you know, they're gonna lower with the radiator anyway.
Okay, so I went to disconnect this big gnarly connector. First of all, I used the pry tool and popped it off the radiator, but there is a little tab that I did break. So just so you know, for anybody for the future, this tab, you don't pull it out, you push it in. And when you push it in, it is supposed to cam the little retainer there and lift it off to unsnap from the mating little tab here. So since I broke this off, I just went in with a flat blade screwdriver and gently lifted that up from that little slot there. I'm guessing that's why they have that slot there as well as a safety. So I was able to separate that connector. Now, it's still connected to the radiator in two spots with these wire ties. So I'm just gonna cut those ties and then put it back, because obviously I can't have that cable hanging up when I go to lower the radiator. Okay, so I did get the two bolts off that are on top of this bracket. It's kind of hard to see in there. I can get the phone in there. That hold the radiator on. I don't know how the hell I'm gonna get them back in. And I'll tell you, they were both loose. So somebody's been in here before. And there's a plastic spacer around at least one. I think the other one, if it has one, I dropped it. I gotta find it. So next for these two, and we'll see if we can lower the radiator. Okay, so I did this already to kind of test run it, but what I did is I took out the one bolt and I just loosened the other. And I got my little catch pan under here in case something lets go and this thing starts dumping coolant. But what this allows me to do is lift up and then pivot the bracket out. I just did it a minute ago. And that way I can keep the bracket there for safety should I need to zing it back in. So see, the bracket's loose. I think I hung up on the grommet. Yeah, I'm hung up on the grommet. Must have got pinched. There we go. So now I can, yeah, swing that out of the way, and I can kind of feel the weight and lower this and see. I'm going to check my clearances. It appears to be hanging, but I don't want to pop the top hose. I'm more concerned about this air conditioning, so I want to check that real well. Well, I have room on the lower hose for sure. It's the question, yeah, the lower hose will allow this to come down. Of course, I've got my lift here. It's gonna block it a little bit, but I'm coming down. I'm not gonna be able to move the camera while I do this, but I am coming out of the top a little bit. So I kind of want to see what the hose feels like inside. Yeah, there's a little bit of slack on the bigger hose, but I'm hitting the air duct. Okay, well, I can kind of see my fingers a little bit now. I don't know if I can lower it enough to get around the tank. Well, got a gap up at the top, so it is dropping out, but I'd have to get over that tank, and I don't think I'm gonna get low enough unless I can move this back a little too. Friction is here. Well, maybe I can get my hand in around. There we go. Okay, so I got my hand in around the right-hand side, and I'm right on that hose. That may be all I need to get a tool in there and break that free. Okay, I do have the camera set up here to try to capture some of this chaos. I've got the new Constant Force clamp here. James Laporte sent me these from Apex Motorsports. Hope I'm saying that name right. So I've got my tool here to open this. Get around. I don't know how this is going to work trying to reach in there to do this. I'm probably going to feel things out a little bit here before I try to do this. And I've got the cutter to cut the old clamp. Again, I don't know if I can get any of this stuff in here. I'm just going to pull this foam out and throw it on the side. Just anything to give me some visibility room. I'm going to at least try to see if I can see it. Yeah, I can see it. I want to make sure I have the right clamp here. I'm going to try to eye this clamp up. Actually, I don't think I do have the right clamp. It's hard to say. No, I think it's one of the smaller ones. I have the right clamp, a little unsure, appears to be for a 16 millimeter hose, but regardless, I'm going to work on cutting the old clamp off. Oh, interesting enough, I got some coolant leak here in the bin. Oh, I'm not going to do anything yet until I see where this coolant's coming from. So moving something around, I got a leak. I'm gonna check this out here. Let me see. Let me see if I can figure out where this coolant's coming from. It's leaking right back here. I don't know where though, from above. I'm going to find that before I go any further. That's a pretty good clue. Camera's probably not going to pick this up, but there's a little hose all the way up, and it's got two drips on it. It's kind of in the center of the frame right there. You see those two little drips? And that's not the leak. Whatever's leaking is happening above it. So I got to lower her down and look from the top. I'm starting to wonder if it isn't the main hose going to the radiator in the engine bay. You know, I was only looking at the evidence of the old crust on my old hose, but the leak always happened right about where it's happening right now in the car from a standpoint passenger, you know, corner. So that's interesting. So
I decided to put the pressure tester on. I don't know if this is happening because of the pressure test, but that's right in the spot where this leak was before. So So I don't think the hose I'm going after is the problem.
Which is good.
Well, of course, this could be worse. So there's my drip right there. So it's coming up. Obviously, it's wicking down. So I gotta figure out, well, the fact that I was pulling on the radiator, I'm gonna guess it's the main feed, you know, out of the block to the radiator.
Well, I'm trying to video it, but this hose right here, that comes from the overflow tank back to the radiator at the connection to the bottom of the tank, I can move it up and down. I think that's my leak.
So anyway, if I lift this up here, if you can see this, if I do this, see how I'm pulling that? Up, down, up, down, I'm moving it. So there's my leak right there. And if I pull my hand out, it's wet. Okay guys, so what I ended up finding is this hose right here is the one that goes to the top of the radiator. In that area I was reaching around, it comes from the overflow tank. So I haven't videoed all of this, but I got a lot of the fasteners out here so I could raise this tank up. And let me show you what I found with this hose. So with the tank loose, it might be harder to do this with the video. There you go, see? I'm able to move that hose up and down. So that clamp is compromised. So I think that that's where my leak is actually coming from, see? And then, you know, my hand will be a little bit wet here. Okay, I've wiped a lot of it off. So I've gone ahead and there's two bolts in the front of this tank housing. I don't know if you'll be able to see the flange. There you go, there's one. There's one on each side, a bolt, and then there's a nut in the middle. If you look at this back, this flange goes between, there's a fixed fastener here, and there's this aluminum cap. These aluminum caps are on the front as well, and then there's a nut there. So you gotta put this fork in between, and then you tighten the nut from going underneath in front. So I've also taken out a clamp for the hose there, and I just took another clamp out on this metal hose. There's actually four hoses that go to the bottom side. So there's another clamp right here that I took off, allowing this metal hose to flex. That's for a larger 24 millimeter hose, I believe, that one that you see all the way to the right. So I don't know if I'm gonna do all four of these. I probably should. It's gonna depend on the access. So I'm gonna just test now and see if I can get the cutting tool in there to cut those clamps off. And of course, I'll do them one at a time, but that's my next step. Of course, I did unplug this electrical connector as well. So this is my suspect one. I'll get that connector out of the way. So I'm gonna try to see if, you know, I don't think I'm gonna have a problem cutting that off and dealing with it. So that's my first primary goal here, is to just solve the leak. Okay, so with this tool and a combination of my Kinpex snips, I was able to get in here and get that clamp cut. So now I'm just gonna spread it around and get it out of there, and then put on a new clamp. I don't know if I'm gonna do the other three. These are not easy to get to. So I don't wanna make more of a mess than I already got. So I'm spreading that around right now. I don't wanna drop it in the engine bay either. It's pretty loose. So there it is. You can see it's all wet around there. Oh no, I hope the hose isn't compromised. The hose is compromised. I can feel it.
So hopefully I got enough slack there in the hose. I think I should, because replacing that hose means I'm back at the radiator. So I got a little hole right there. Yep. So I'm going to have to cut that hose and then go up higher.
Okay, so removing the hose is pretty uneventful here. I managed to get a small paint mixing cup in there to catch any coolant, and now I gotta cut that hose back and then start getting the clamp on. So when I had the clamp on, I initially thought the hose had a break in it, and now that I've got this out and I'm looking it over real good, I don't believe it does. I'm trying to get the camera to focus here. I don't believe it does. It's just the outer part of the hose is compressed from the clamp. So I'm looking it over real well, because I'd rather not cut it if I don't need to. So I'm just checking to make sure that there is no fracture in this hose. I looked on the inside too, and I don't see anything. I'd rather not lose that additional, I guess it's about 3/4 of an inch. I'll have to just look this over real well and make a judgment call on what I want to do. Okay, so I did decide to cut off about 5/8, 3/4 of length here beyond that prior clamp squeeze, and now I'm getting ready to put on the new clamp and get this connected up.
Well, it's a Sunday, and I had really a couple of clamp options to get the job done. These clamps here, which are crappy worm gear clamps, or this high pressure fuel injection collar. What I like about this is that the edge of the band is rounded, and the notches, if you will, won't dig in the hose. So I decided to use this clamp, although one thing I don't like is really the tightness, or I should say how tight to make it. And I'm concerned about that loosening up over time, but I think just the tension holds it. So I've got it on there, and I think I'm going to throw the pressure tester on and just give it a quick test again and see how that goes, and then start putting the car back together. Well, I got some bad news. I've been putting this together, and I saw a drip here and came and looked up here. Let me get the light on. And I think I have a leak at the top of the radiator. So this foam up here is wet. And I mean, unless the other leak wicked over here, I don't think so. I mean, it's all wet. I don't know how the other one would have wicked all the way over here. I think the radiator itself is leaking. So I'm uncertain if I have another leak. See, there's some coolant around that hose, which I know is not coming from the hose. But if you look at the shroud to the radiator, you see a little bit of coolant there. And up above, that foam seemed wet. Now, it's possible that when some coolant came out when I did the other hose, that that's residual, just wicking out. I really don't think so. See, it's a little wet right there. I don't think it is, because it wasn't in this area. There's a drip about ready to start. I think the radiator's leaking itself, but the pressure really hasn't dropped yet. And I think I lost a half a PSI. So I'm gonna let this sit for tonight and just see what drips where, or if it let go, if it, you know, lets go. I'm gonna try to put some sort of catch pan under here. But I don't think I've got this solved yet. Shit. Okay, I'm absolutely losing my mind. So there's coolant here on the opposite side of where it's been leaking. There's some coolant there. I still have the pressure tester on. It has dropped 1 PSI in like, what, 18 hours, something like that. I didn't do the math yet. So I got some coolant here. And then the buckets have, there's a little bit in that one that wasn't there last night. I'll raise it up here once I get going today and check it out. I don't know what the hell's going on. But clearly, unless this is the leftover residual just finding its way out of the car, I did lose some when I pulled that hose off and some poured out. I don't know, I gotta check everywhere. But the pressure is holding way better now than it did the last time I did the test.
Okay, so under the car, looking for leaks. So I got a drip there. There's some dripping right here. So this could be residual, and that's landed right there. That's not far from where the tank is. So I got to try to follow that up and see if I see any wetness up above or on top of the frame rail. Okay, and then I've got this big puddle here, which is very alarming. And that's coming from there part now too. And see what's going on in there. Well, I could see part of the radiator from here. Interesting enough. Oh, and I see there's that little clamp on the hose there, and I see coolant on that. It's back this piece right here. So I'm gonna get on top of the car and look around and feel around and see if I feel any wetness from above. But that's a piece of evidence for sure. And obviously that is too. I don't think it's dripping anymore. Yeah, it's even on the lift arm here. Nothing really on top. Let's see what the radiator looks like on this side. So I got that same drip right here. But that's what was going in the bucket. And then there's another one up here. So, yep, there's a drip right there. And a drip on the frame right there. I clearly have leaks. I wiped the side of the radiator yesterday. Let me see if it's dry. It is. That's the hose, the main hose up there. I'm gonna mess with that connection. I'm just gonna grab that hose and twist and turn it. But I see here's a drip right here. So, I mean, some of this could be wicking. I gotta really get up top and feel everything around and try to determine what's going on up on top. I'm taking the tank off again, and there's a puddle of coolant under it. So one of the other hoses is leaking. I don't think that was residual. I gotta check, but I'm gonna redo those connections. Yeah. Okay, here's the overflow outlet. I gotta remove that clamp that goes to the hose right there, a hole to drop down, so I'll take that off. Okay, so this is the driver's side of the car, and I got some coolant drips on the lower hose. I see a little residue at this hose here, so if I could set the light up here, I would that's wet. So I'm leaking at the lower part of this connection, so that's gonna get changed. I just saw another drip up in here. Right there is a drip. So that means something above is going. So this whole side of the car has got to come apart and I got to do all those connections. So something up above is dripping. Let's see, connection at the water pump here. That looks okay, but obviously that's going to get changed now. Yeah, I mean, I'm right there. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do all these that are accessible. Okay, so this is the overflow drain tube, and this hose clamp connection has a nut behind it, so you gotta get back there with a wrench and get this nut off, because I'm working to remove this bracket to gain some access. I still got two more screws back there, but I gotta get this bracket out of the way so that I can get my hand back in there. Okay, behind that clamp is a spacer before the bracket. Okay, after finding some other leaks, this lower radiator hose, there's a leak. There's leaks coming from above. I decided that, you know, while I'm into this, I'm going to reclamp all the hose connections. So I took apart the driver's side of the car to get it basically to the same level as the passenger side. And now I'm getting ready to drain the system. I've got a tub here and a bucket. So what I'm gonna do is go to either this line on the radiator or on the block here, probably here. I think I'm gonna do that'll be a little bit easier to access. And I'll see if I might hang the 5-gallon bucket somewhere. But if not, when I go to pull that hose, I'm gonna just, you know, basically just point it right in there and see. Hopefully I don't make too much of a mess, but I've got another bucket that I could use to elevate this, and I may do that. I don't have another cart here to elevate it, but I'll find a way to get this sorted, and we'll get it done.
So I was able to find a cooler to get my catch basin a little bit higher. I got some 5-gallon buckets, and I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna cut this clamp off. I'll probably set up the camera here and try to video it and video the circus that it's going to be when it pours all over the place. Oh yeah, that's a mess. Nice to taste a little bit of coolant. I'm joking, of course.
Okay, so I got a little bit of a mess, not too bad. I did taste a little bit, but I'm just letting this drain out here. And what I'm gonna do is let this drain as much as possible, and then I'm gonna reclamp this hose. I'm gonna basically do that, you know, throughout, because the point of this exercise is not really changing the coolant, it's to reclamp the hoses. Okay, so with the lower radiator hose disconnected, I was able to get the top hose disconnected, which allowed me to tilt this radiator quite a bit, as you can see. And I just cut the clamp on this overflow hose right now, and I'm getting ready to pull that hose off. But before I do, I want to be prepared with the clamp to put it back on so I can reassemble this right now. So you see the condenser lines flex pretty well and allow pretty good access into the radiator here. It's not awesome. Clamping the top is still going to be fun.
What I may do is actually put the clamp over the tube, right, or the hose right now. I don't really want to do that, but I might. I got to kind of think this through and come up with a game plan.
So the plot thickens as it always does. So that radiator hose has a slight cut on the outside. It does not go through, but I'm this far in, I have a hard time stomaching leaving it, and I was almost fully connected up there and I noticed it. So here's the tonneau cover open, which you can do, by the way, with the car not being started. And looks like we got a coolant sensor here, but the hose, you know, that side of it, I believe, goes to the top of the radiator. Obviously, this side would be easier to get to. That side's going to be a little harder, but I believe that is it. And I'm going to look to replace that hose. So, plot thickens.
So it's impossible to see in there. So I got the top hose connected along with the overflow hose, which I did last week. So I put the endoscope in there and inspected not only the clamp, but the seating of the hose on the nipple. And I'm generally pleased with it, except there's, well, that's the overflow. There's a, the clamp position is right past the nipple, or the bulge in the nipple, so I like that. There's one spot where the hose is not totally against the flat face of the radiator. You'll see it right there, that little gap, but it's beyond the barb and it's clamped, so I'm not too worried about it. Again, there's that overflow clamp I did last week, so I'm ready to put this radiator passenger side back.
Okay, at this point I have the new upper radiator hose assembly installed. I just installed the coolant sensor. I have not connected the electrical connection yet. I want to get this other clamp on here. Oops, sorry. And after I do that, the passenger side radiator is complete with the exception of the lower hose being connected. I didn't want to connect that until this is completely done, so that I know in case I'm going to take anything apart again, I don't have to unconnect it. So I'm going to take care of this, or attempt to right now, with the constant tension hose clamp. Okay, so I have that new upper radiator hose connected with the constant tension clamp. I bought those from Belmetric. Now that is size 43 millimeter, okay? So I tested with the test piece to make sure that that wouldn't turn or was secure. Also, I have the coolant sensor connected. Now I took an inspection mirror and I went around even the bottom and I checked two things to see how well the, just turn the light off. I checked to see how well the hose was seated on the aluminum adapter, and also to see where the clamp ended up being around that perimeter. I just wanted to make sure the clamp didn't go askew and it wrapped right around. So you can also feel, well, that's, I have the old clamp mark here, but generally you can feel that it's at the barb, and I'm feeling around on the underside. And I can feel right now that my clamp is right on the other side of the barb, so I feel pretty good about this. So aside from putting the access cover back on, which I'm not gonna do until after I pressure test the system, I've got this one last piece to put on. So when I pulled off the old hose, off came this hose clamp. So what I did is I looked down the other side here, the camera's maybe not gonna, I don't know if it's gonna pick it up. Yeah, well, you might, yeah, you actually do see it there. So it's obviously holding the big radiator hose and another small one. So here, again, I don't know if the camera's gonna
pick it up. You see the smaller hose back there? So I'm gonna go ahead and get this installed to connect those two, to hold them together. I'm not so sure it's needed, but it was there. I don't wanna have parts left over. Okay, so you're probably not gonna see the other hose, but there is that clip reinstalled, and it attaches from the main top radiator hose to the overflow fill hose. So that's kind of behind it. It's dark, you can't see it. I did it totally blind by just reaching my hand in there and snapping the two together.
Okay, so I just connected the lower radiator hose on the passenger side. This is also a 43 millimeter constant tension clamp from Bell Metric. This is probably the second easiest connection of the job, aside from the connections to the water pump housing. So I did also, you know, still check that hose seating all the way around the nipple, and I checked the clamp all the way around the perimeter for position. You know, these clamps can go on an angle, so you have to make sure you've got them, you know, somewhat same distance all the way around from the edge of the hose. And, you know, I did feel that it's right on the barb too, so I feel pretty good about that. So this side is complete, you know, from a hosing standpoint and some mounting. I still have wiring to do and things. I'm gonna leave all that be for right now. I'm gonna get the other side done, and then I wanna pressure test the system before I start mechanically putting the car back together. So actually, just for completeness, before I move to the other side, I did add these two Torx fasteners underneath on the radiator post to secure that. I've got wire ties to do yet to connect these pieces together. There's some clips that have to go in. I have to reconnect the connector for the radiator. There's some various little pieces that have to be done, but again, I want to leave that stuff alone just to be sure this doesn't have to come out again. Okay, getting ready to drop the driver's side radiator. I'm going to try to do a little better job documenting this. So I'm going to start by removing these under radiator screws. They're Torx head screws. Then I'm going to cut the wire tie for this line here so that'll allow some flexibility. Now, one of the fun things on this side, I've already dismantled some of this, is the fuel filler hose runs in here. So it's gonna be a little bit of added baggage to try to work around along with this line too. So I'm hoping that these lines are gonna flex as well. But I gotta get at that upper hose connection, so this is gonna be fun. So Jay, I have the passenger side done, unbelievably, but I have it done. And I was getting ready to start on the driver's side. I was gonna I got the bottom already connected with a constant tension, but I was gonna do the upper two hoses. And as I was about to get into this, I realized this other condenser line is gonna be a lot more rigid than the passenger side. And I don't this line is pretty rigid. I don't think it's gonna allow me the flexibility to move this radiator around as I need, along with the fact that I've got the fuel filler hose coming down this side. So I just paused and I'm giving this some thought. I think to do this side, I gotta evacuate the AC, and I'm not in love with that. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna hold up right now. I'm gonna work on the underside of the overflow tank because I know I had more leaks there. I'm gonna get that done. Once that's done, I'm also gonna run the endoscope up at the top and see if I see any, you know, leaking up at the top section. But what I'm gonna do is evaluate before I go too deep into this. If I don't see anything apparent up there, and maybe I would even consider putting a double clamp on if it's the main hose. I don't know, I'm gonna evaluate, but I'm not gonna start ripping into this till I know what's going on, because if it's okay, I'm gonna leave well enough alone. I'm gonna do the underside of the overflow. I'm gonna pressurize the system again and let it sit and see what happens. Because this looks like a can of worms, and I'm not ready to go down a can of worms here if I don't have to.
Okay, so I wanna document the whole hose path underneath this overflow tank. So the left, if you're looking at it from the back of the car, the leftmost nipple goes to this hose I just took off, which is reaching down. It is this one here, I believe. I'm gonna follow that through. No, it is not. It is, which one here? Okay, so the one I did not remove yet is this hose right here. And you can see, the camera's not focusing. It goes right there. So this one actually goes right there. It's where my thumb is touching. And then of course, on the other side, these are all same size hoses. This one here, of course, it tucks under the bracket. That's the most right connection. Okay, so you got right, center, and left, and of course the large one, which is self-explanatory. So I have three of the four hoses off the expansion tank, and this one I had reclamped prior, and then when I ran a pressure test, I had another leak. Well, here you go. I don't know if I can do this with one hand, but I'm moving this hose. I don't know if you see that. There you go. Okay, so clearly that was my other leaker right there. Yeah, I'm rotating that, no problem. That's loose connection right there. So that was clearly the culprit. Okay, so I'm starting to reclamp the hoses under the overflow tank with constant tension clamps. Now, this is not the easiest thing to get into, especially with the tool. So what I decided to do is the middle first, then I'm gonna do this left-hand side, then the right-hand side, and then the large center, or perhaps the large center, and then the right. But there's not a lot of wiggle room here to get the tool in. But I am using this Kinpex special tool that works pretty good. It does allow you to kind of turn once you get the clamp on, because these little teeth here will rotate. So I got the one going, we'll get the others going. Okay, so I did the center first, the far left next, and I'm changing my mind. I'm gonna do this larger one next, and then the one to the right. Now, these three smaller ones are 16 millimeter, and this is a 24 millimeter. Okay, so I just added the clamp on the 24 millimeter. That one's a little challenging because it doesn't have a lot of slack. It's actually a short piece of hose that goes to this metal tube. So there's not a lot of slack there, but it's doable. So onto the last 16 millimeter on the other side, and then this will be ready to go. Okay, so I've got the last one on the 16 millimeter. You can see in the mirror there, I'm just looking for clamp position and it's on straight and things of that nature. Like this car is impossible to see anything. So what I'm gonna do is put the tank in, but I'm not going to screw any of the fasteners at this point, and then I'm going to pressurize the system for about an hour or two, and then I'm going to relieve the pressure and I'm going to repressurize. And what I want to do here is I want to seat all these constant tension clamps, so I don't want to do my pressure test without doing the pre-pressure first, and then I'll do a secondary after. Okay, so I've pressurized the system to one bar, just under 15 PSI. And you'll see I have it where the needle is right to the top of the black one bar mark, right at the bottom of the 15 PSI mark. So I'm gonna leave this for a few hours, and I'm not gonna call it an official test yet, because if it drops a little bit in a couple hours, I'm gonna repump it and then start from zero, because I want the constant tension clamps to seat. In the meantime, while I'm waiting for that, I'm gonna get the endoscope out, raise the car up, and fish around at the upper radiator connections and see what they look like and see if there's any potential issue there. Okay, I'm getting ready to vacuum down the coolant system and add coolant. And I've got a snap-on vacuum filler for the McLaren here. The adapter you need is a TA72.
wasn't that much. I think this adapter was, I got a Snap-on discount, but I want to say it was, I don't know, $55, something like that. And the tool was around $300 thereabouts.
Okay, so the way this Snap-on tool works is there's a couple ears here that you drop over here and turn it, obviously, so it's underneath the rim. And then it's got a like a cam action here. So when I turn this lever, okay, there you go, that's sprung, and there's pins in here. And you can turn it again. Sorry, I'm doing this with one hand. When you turn that, it compresses the spring, pulls the spring up. So I'm gonna put this on. Rotate over a bit, and then there you go. So now it's locked on.
Okay, so the Snap-on tool has a very short hose for exhaust or any kind of mist you're gonna get out, and I don't love that because I don't want to put a catch can on the car here, so I have a longer piece of hose that I extended so I can just put this right into a bucket on the floor. But I've got these connectors here, so I'm just gonna tape this up so I don't have to worry about any of this scratching the tape. So I just wrapped a piece of Velcro actually around this and the soft edge, this way I don't gotta worry about any paint getting hurt. So I'm gonna connect some air up, I'm gonna drape this blanket over a little bit better, and we'll get going.
Okay, so I've got coolant mixed 50-50. This is the Xerox coolant. Got to mix 50-50 in these cat litter containers. I cleaned them first, of course, and I've got them mixed with distilled water. So I've got 2 gallons in here, 2 gallons in here. This is waste. So I ran the waste hose in there. I don't love the fact that they don't give you just a longer hose. I've got my air connected. The compressor may kick on. I got a little bit of a leak in the system here I got to take care of. But anyway, so I've got the coolant also raised up higher than the fill point, and I didn't have any clamps here, so I just stuffed some paper towels in here. The hose is all the way down just to make sure that this wouldn't come up or anything like that. So I'm getting ready to just pull some vacuum and see how it goes. Of course, then we got to purge this line. So I got the hose dripped in there, so we're gonna get some bubbling. If that bubbles up too much, I'll empty that. I just wanted to use the same container I already had. I can pull the hose back, of course. I'll just let it sit like that. So I'm gonna hold this like this for a minute anyway, because I wanna purge this line. So I'm gonna introduce a little bit of coolant here. Okay, just a little bit more. All right, so now we've got that line purged of air, and I'm gonna go ahead and put the vacuum back on.
I'm gonna go ahead and put the vacuum back on and see what we pull here. I'll leave the compressor running this time.
Okay, I let the system sit for 5 minutes, and then I let basically let it stabilize, and then I re-put the vacuum on and I pulled down another couple inches of mercury, and I actually stopped it at 25. So I'm actually gonna do this again and see if it pulls down a little further. Okay, it seems to stop right at 25 inches of mercury. So I'm gonna let this sit and see if this drifts at all over a couple minutes.
Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and fill this again. This container is at a higher level than here. So we'll get started. And I've got 2 gallons in there. So I'll pay attention.
this goes pretty quick. Watch that level drop. And I'll stop it maybe around here if I need to change the container. Okay, I'm gonna stop it here. I'll change this out. I can even pour that into the other container. Okay, so when I swap containers, I did introduce a little bit of air in that hose, about maybe 6 inches or so. So I did pull vacuum again, and now I'm going to go ahead and refill. Now, between these two jugs, I've got 4 gallons, and I don't really think I'm gonna fill more than 4 gallons in the system based on what I took out. Well, I'm gonna stop that. Okay, what I did is I stopped here because with the hose in, I can dump more coolant in from the top. So it's kind of looking like it might take some more. So I'm gonna mix up another couple gallons and top this jug off. Okay, so I mixed up another 2 gallons. So total, I would have 6 gallons mixed. I don't think the car's capacity is that. So I'm gonna pull again. Oh, it looks like we're pretty close to being full here. We're almost down to zero. Looks like we're down, and it has stopped moving. Down to zero. Put my nail there. Other than shaking the bottle, nope, no more movement. Okay, so as I remove the filler, you see it filled right up into the adapter here. So obviously I'm a little high. So I'll use a siphon and I'll pull a little bit of this out. Okay, so I siphoned a little bit out and I have it right at the fill line here, and we're ready to go. So essentially the factory used ear clamps, they're crimp-on clamps, and I'll show some of that more in the video. And what they need to be is constant tension clamps because of the expansion and contraction. So my synopsis from what I found is anywhere there's an ear clamp on a metal bib, like at the water pump and things of that nature, those seem to have pretty good integrity. But the culprits seem to be at plastic bibs, like the radiators, the overflow tank, and things of that nature. So up until the time of this intro, I found 4 leaking hoses. The passenger side radiator had the upper two, the small overflow return and the main return line were leaking.
The lower, I don't think the lower was leaking, but I had to pull that whole radiator basically out, so I changed all three of those clamps. And then I had another two leaks for sure on the underside of the overflow. Now, I was not positive if I had a leak on the driver's side radiator. I think I did. I changed the lower clamp. I did not change the upper because I believe I was gonna have to evacuate the AC system, and I didn't wanna do that. So we have a short, you know, driving season here in Buffalo, just a few months. And I got to a point where I said, you know what, I didn't work on this all through the winter. I was doing it in early spring, you know, early summer, if you will. And I said, you know what, I want to get the car on the road. I want to drive it. So I had half the damn car apart. This car is impossible to work on. You got to be a whole lot skinnier than me to get your hands in all these areas. And it was a mess. So I put the car back together. I've been driving it, probably drove it maybe 1,000 miles. And I still have a leak. Now, basically, as you can imagine, when you have a bigger leak, that's the point of least resistance. That's where you get the leak. So as you start sealing up larger leaks, you expose perhaps a smaller leak. So what I believe is going on is I have a leak in one spot because I'm seeing coolant drip on my garage floor in the same spot. So I don't think it's bouncing around. I think I got a one spot leak. And I have to add about a coffee cup of coolant every 100 miles or so. So I'm monitoring it, I'm watching it. There's no problems with overheating. Needless to say, I don't want to be doing this. I want to solve the problem. So maybe even before I finish posting this video, I'm going to throw the car back up and see if I can find that leak. Hopefully it's something radically obvious that I can resolve, but we'll see. But this video is not any kind of step-by-step. It's not anything of that sort, but there is procedures in here on how to vacuum, fill the coolant. And then there's a whole bunch of other material. I wasn't trying to do any kind of step-by-step. So take it for what it's worth. There's some value, maybe some non-value. I'm gonna put it all together, collage it, and try to put it in the sequence of order the best I can. Okay, so I've driven the car about 1,000 miles since refilling the coolant system. You see I have this coolant on the floor here. This is the most I've had on the floor since I've been taking the car out. I've been having just a couple of drops, but this is a lot more substantial, and it's in more than one area, but it is going towards the passenger side of the car. So I just put the car up on the lift to take a look, and right when I was racking it, I noticed immediately that there is coolant residue right where you put the lift arm. So before I even pull anything off, I'm just gonna investigate this. So I see some coolant on these fasteners. I see coolant all along the back here. I see residue here. I see residue on the diffuser. I see a little bit here, but I'm gonna suspect that that might be old stuff. Not sure. And when I look here, I see some on this bolt, and I do see some on this pan here. So I'm gonna get the under tray off and have a look, and hopefully it's something really obvious. Okay, so I removed the pan and just started doing a very quick investigation here. And I'm seeing all kinds of coolant right here, and that definitely wasn't there prior. And I see coolant on these lower hoses that wasn't there prior. There's some wet coolant right there. Some coolant on these hoses. So that's giving me obviously the hint that it's higher up. So I see some coolant up here. So I don't see any coming out of the block, thank God. That's all I would need is a head gasket leak. I don't see any of that, but it's coming from above. So I gotta trace where and figure out where the hell the leak is coming from. So I also see that this panel is wet right here. Now that could have just been wicking, but the radiator's under that panel. So that's pretty easy to get that off. I'm probably gonna take that panel off now as well. So as I started to remove the panel that goes underneath the radiator, you see that I've got some pretty good drip in here. So I pull that down. There's obviously coolant puddled up underneath there. So obviously that's a good hint that it's dripping in that area. But again, don't know where yet. I'm gonna get that panel off and then try to get up above.
Okay, so I got that panel off and you see a lot of coolant collecting there, and obviously it's dripping right here now and dripping here. So let's see if we can see anything up above. Here's the radiator. I mean, it's very difficult to see up there. What I suspect is it could be the overflow return line hose leaking from the bottom side of the overflow tank again and then wicking down the hose towards the radiator and coming down here. I mean, that's pure speculation at this point, but the lower radiator hose is clean. That looks good. I don't see anything on the radiator itself. That looks good. I don't see anything up above that's obvious. Now, there is this lower hose, which is fine, but you see how it rests on the frame? I sure hope that's fine. Let me try to position the light here somewhere. There we go. Let's hope that this hose isn't compromised. Well, it's sure wet there. I think it's just wet from coolant leaking on the felt that it's resting on. I don't feel any compromise on this. I'm gonna pressure test it and see. But if I run my fingers in there, I'm not feeling any kind of cut or anything like that. I mean, that's kind of the area that it's coming from. I think that's just pure coincidence. I think it's dripping from above on there. Yeah, I'm not feeling any compromise on the hose there. But I do see coolant. See that coolant on the bottom side of the hose? So, but it's all wet up in here too. So I gotta get up above and look. Okay, so I think my suspicion is correct. Now, if I look in there, it's a little hard to focus, but you see there's right in the center of the screen, there's an adapter there. That's a transition piece where the coolant sensor goes. And then you got to the left, as shown in the screen, goes to the motor, to the right goes to the upper part of the radiator. That upper radiator hose I replaced. And, you know, I'm looking there because it's on that side of the car. I'm looking to see if the coolant sensor, which has a crush washer, would be leaking. And it does not appear to be leaking, nor do either of the connections. So now I come over here, and I think my suspicion is correct. So I look on top. It's going to be a little hard to see this. I look on top of the coolant filter cartridge, and it's got coolant all over it, residue anyway. And I see coolant on the hoses down here. I'll try to get the camera in. The camera actually helped me see more. So I'm doing this a little bit blind here, just putting the camera in, but I see some coolant residue there. So I suspect that I'm leaking on the underside of the overflow tank, which I replaced. I did all the clamps there. So either there's a compromise in the tank, or perhaps one of the clamps is still leaking. So I'm looking at this. I have the camera inside tucked underneath, and I can barely see the front now, but I think I see a drip happening. I'm gonna hold the camera here for just a second. Yep, right there, there's a drip. I don't know where that drip's coming from. Hard to see with the camera, but it's dripping right there. And so I'll check that out. Maybe that hose is pierced, but I'll pressure test it, and then we'll go from there. All right, so I just put my fingers underneath that hose, and they're all wet. So clearly, I think my suspicion's correct. I think that this overflow tank's leaking. So again, I'm gonna pressure test it to see if I can find the leak, but as I'm looking in there, I see this hose dripping right now. Well, it's actually dripping at a little connection that holds, again, sorry here, two hoses together. But it's all wet. So certainly that's a leak. Okay, I removed the overflow cover here, and I'm gonna try to get the camera down in here to see. believe it or not, I can actually see with the camera better than I can my eyes, and see the wetness on that hose. And that's where I saw it drip. So I'm imagining it's running down the hose, and where it meets this cable or this hose connector, it starts pooling there. And see, yeah, it's all wet there. So if I take my fingers underneath this hose. Now the interesting thing is this is on the other side of the, this is the driver's side of the car. But this hose is all wet. I don't feel any compromise here. Now the car is still a little warm here. So, you know, I'm trying to get the camera in here to see anything. It's impossible to see. I'll get my borescope in there and see if I can pick up anything. Okay, so I have my endoscope on this and I'm looking on the underside of the overflow tank, and it looks like that's a culprit right there. And there's some coolant on top of that, well, the bottom side of the clamp, which is the dead giveaway. If I had residue there from before, it wouldn't have been on that clamp. So the other ones, if I can position this while recording, you can see the one next to it looks okay. That one looks okay. And I can't get the other one from this view, I don't think. We'll see. But that looks to be the problem right there. So again, I'll probably pressure test this and see if I can make the leak happen real time. So I have the pressure tester on and you can see the drip right here, but I'm just trying to see if that is running down the hose or if the hose has got a leak there. I think it's running down the hose.
Okay, so underneath the expansion tank, there's three 16-millimeter hoses and then a larger one. I forget the size right now. The larger one is very tight with these constant force clamps. These were loose. In fact, I was able to pull them all off the hose barbs, which aren't very large, by the way, without even removing the clamps, just because I couldn't get the wrench in there real well. So one was leaking pretty severely. I'm suspecting the others were maybe leaking as well. And maybe these should have been 15 millimeter clamps, but these are kind of flimsy. They don't have the force that the bigger clamps have, of course. So I had tried these fuel line clamps, 14 to 16 millimeter. And the problem is the hose is 16 millimeters. When they choke down to 14, it's just not tight enough to lock that hose. So this is not the same clamp. It's a very similar clamp. Could even be the same manufacturer. No, these are made in Sweden, stainless steel. This one is nominally a 13. I also have a 14 millimeter here. And I'm gonna try the 13 millimeter first. I think the 13 is the smallest size, but I'll check that out. I mean, I'll see where it measures right now. Here, I could do this with the calipers. I'm doing this with one hand. Well, let's kind of get a feel where this is right now. Okay, so right now this is at a little over 14 millimeters. So that'll actually clamp down less than 13, I'm sure of it. So actually, that being said, I may start with these 14. Let's see what these measure in their current state. So yeah, these are 16 right now, and I think I'll start with these and see. I mean, that's gonna compress quite a bit there. So I think that should do it, and we'll get a good seal, so we'll give that a try. Okay, so this is the prior 14 to 16 millimeter clamp that I used, and you can see I've tightened that all the way down, and we'll see where that goes here. That goes to, call it 13 1/4 millimeters. So now I've taken one of the 14 millimeter nominal clamps and I've tightened that down. You can already see it goes considerably lower. Now it's a little bit oblong, obviously, because there's no, it's not wrapped around a hose, but let's just see what this is. So this is 12 millimeters. So I believe that's the one I'm going to use versus the 13 that should get me, because these were just about there. They were tight, but not enough. I could still wiggle the clamp or turn the clamp a little bit, but this should lock it up completely.
Okay, as I got into this, I changed my mind again, and I decided to go with the 13 millimeter size and not the 14. And you see that the clamp is all the way open here, and I have pushed it on the hose. So it's pretty tight on the hose. I mean, it's not a super hard press, but it's on there very good. I mean, I could turn that if I wanted to, but I had cut off a little bit of this hose prior, about a half inch, and some of the hoses still have a squeeze in from the prior clamp. This one really doesn't, because I cut that area off. So using this, it allows me a little bit more freedom to get a little tighter. And with this open like this, I'll be able to actually push this right over the barb on the nipple and then proceed to tighten it. I have the center one on right now. You're probably not gonna see this in here. Yeah, it's kind of hard to see, but the one is on there. Does you see the hex of the clamp? And I've used the endoscope to check how the seating is of the hose, and it's perfectly flush against the bottom of the over or expansion tank.
So this is rather interesting as well. I went to unplug this connector and this sensor actually pulled right out. This goes into the expansion tank on the bottom, and it's just an O-ring seal. But as I look at this, I don't know if the camera's gonna pick this up. It looks just like, you know, simple contact in this tube. And what would make you think that this is some sort of level sensor, but it's gotta be activated through heat, with the heat of the coolant to open or close that circuit, you know, simple switch here. Obviously that circuit couldn't, there's no way that's gonna pick up level. It's not any kind of, you know, leveling sensor, if you will. So I would think that this would just be an on-off based on heat, if there's anything in the system. So I mentioned it to a buddy, he did a quick search, and he said something that McLaren never enabled this, and it was supposed to be a level sensor. It was pretty stupid that it's not activated, if that's the case, because it would make great sense. And I've never had a low coolant warning, so it's pretty indicating that this sensor is not being used.
Okay, so I'm getting ready to connect the last of the small hoses. Now, if anybody else is ever doing this, what I found easiest to do is to do the center small hose first, okay, and then do the driver's side on a left-hand drive car, so the left-hand side, and then come over and do the right-hand side. And you'll see the center and the left go in that bracket channel to the left, where only the right is in that larger opening to the right. So it's a little easier because you can get at the hex of the clamp to tighten it.
So sure enough, I have the sensor out. I charge the system to 5 PSI, nothing dropped. So that's going into a cavity. It's not going in the wet coolant.
Okay, car up in the air. So a little wetness here. That was all dry yesterday. Now that could be a little bit of residual. This was all dry. Everything under the car I wiped very dry. So there's just some drips and stuff. And what I would say is the interesting thing is it seems to be kind of uniform. And that would actually kind of indicate maybe residual, but I think the amount that I lost doesn't make sense. If I look at the garage floor from pulling in yesterday, where I left it overnight, I have a very little bit here. So that could certainly be residual, although my drive, I think I would've got rid of it. Oh, here's a little bit here as well. But that looks like it was on the tire. So I know I did have some on the tire, so we'll see. Well, this isn't awesome. There's a drip right on that lower radiator hose. Unless it's coming from above, I don't think so. I'll trace that. Obviously, that's an easy one to correct. Although, that's the clamp I put on.
the constant tension. And this is the driver's side here. Well, there we go. We got a drip right there. So where is that coming from? Is that coming from above, coming down? I don't know. It's the motor's hot right now, so I gotta wait. I gotta feel on top of that. But that's clearly a drip there. And if there's nothing above it, I'm gonna suspect it's that hose clamp, but that's got a constant tension on it. Other than that, I don't see anything radically obvious here, but this is troubling that this would be leaking all of a sudden. So that's very troubling. But the good news here, although I don't want to take that hose off the drain the system, but I could potentially put one of those other screw worm gear constant tension clamps on that. I might be able to open that clamp, get it over on the aluminum, put another hose clamp on there, and then like cut that clamp to get it off. I got more investigating to do here, but that's the obvious stuff right now. So I'm gonna spray some Simple Green on this in a second to get this soaped up, but I just went like this and I could see a little like bubble. It's not wet enough right now. I kind of wiped the coolant over there and I went like this and I could see, but you could also see it does appear I'm moving the, there you go. If I wiggle the hose, I don't know if the camera's picking it up, you can see a bubbling. I'm gonna shit if this thing is leaking here. So there, I sprayed it with a little Simple Green. I don't know if that's gonna help me. I might need to put the pressure test on and squeeze it and see if any coolant comes out. I mean, that would be very alarming if that clamp wasn't, I mean, it's, I hear coolant moving, obviously, that's just moving it through the hose. Well, I have the car pressurized right now, and this is the driver's side of the car that had a drip right here. So I look above it, if you can see this, there's another hose right where my finger's on the clamp that comes in. There's a metal tube here that joins to whatever this piece is. And that is an ear clamp there. And if I put my hand up there, I can wiggle the hose. I can, the motor's still a little hot. Let me just try to zoom this in. I'm not getting any leak there currently, but that could be a place, if it's leaking from there, it could have made that drip. Moving the hose around to see if I can get it to leak, and it's not. Same thing over here. I come to this lower radiator hose, and if I squeeze it and move it, I'm not getting anything to leak now. So I'm going to leave the car pressurized for a while and see if a leak appears. Now, above here, Jay, you were asking about the coolers for the turbo, and again, I'm just learning the system. I believe this is the turbo, and I believe that's how it's getting cooled with those lines there, and I don't see any leaking right there.
Posted it. So as I went at working on the underside of my coolant expansion tank again, I got that buttoned up, but I had the wrong clamps. They just couldn't get as tight as I would have liked. So I halted on that. I did pressure test and it held pretty good, but I still wasn't happy because one of the hoses I could turn a little bit or turn the clamp. So I changed out to clamps, which you guys will see, and then got the car buttoned back together. And yesterday took it out of here. Now I had a little coolant residue inside the engine bay, but I plan to wash that down. Warmed the car up, took it out. And I saw some coolant in the garage and in the driveway. I just went to get gas around the corner, came back in. It was a cloudy, rainy day, so I just parked the car anyway. And I saw I had some coolant under the car. I said, oh, I gotta have another leak. So sure enough, this morning I put the pressure tester on it when it was cold. For 30 minutes, I lost 2 PSI in 30 minutes. So I got another leak. So lifted the car up, you'll see this, took the pan off, and I found 2 points of leak. One was a lower radiator hose clamp at the water pump side. I had changed that clamp before with a constant tension, and it still is leaking, it's dripping. Not great. Another is a different hose on the driver's side of the car that is an ear clamp. I'm going to change that here right now. You'll see that. So I may just reposition the constant tension on the lower radiator hose. I don't know why that would be a problem. That should have been a done deal and over with. So I'm a little concerned about that. The good thing is that's real easy to access. It's at the bottom of the car. So I'm hoping that today is the end of this and I can move forward and drive this car without leaks, but it seems like you fix one and you push the leak somewhere else. But it appears that all the work I did on the underside of the expansion tank is holding very good, and I've solved that area. So we'll get the rest of it done, and then I'll be posting the video. So again, I'm combining this video in a whole series because before I solved the problems, I found more, and I'm just adding more material to combine for the video. So a little long, but hopefully somebody can benefit from even some of the pieces in the video. That's why I'm doing it. And I'm also doing it because I want a diary documentary of what I did. So when these problems reappear, if they reappear, I know what I did. Okay. Thanks for watching, guys. Okay. So I put some pressure on the system for a few hours. Not to pressure test it, but just to, you know, see if I would see some leaks. And there's actually 2 here, but I'm seeing a 3rd now, and I just saw that drip as I'm filming. So that's a little bit concerning that I've got another one now. So I look and we're really wet right here. So I don't love that. So there's something else going on right up above here. But I see here I've got a drip at the bottom of this hose. This is very concerning because I did change that clamp. I'm going to look to make sure there's nothing above that. I did that a little bit earlier and I don't believe there is, but I'm going to check again just to make sure that's not a drip coming from above ending on that hose. I don't think so. Pardon my camera here. If I squeeze the hose, we'll see if we see that. Well, I relieve the pressure in the system right now because I'm going to work on adjusting that. Now, on this side, there is this drip coming off that fitting here, but it's not that. There's another hose above. You can see that ear clamp, and that's actually where it's leaking. Again, I relieve the pressure, but before doing the video, I had it under pressure, and I was squeezing that hose, and right there, I don't know if it's going to show now and the camera's not really in focus, but I was squeezing this and it was absolutely coming out this hose. So again, I've relieved the pressure, so it's probably not going to do it now, but that for sure is leaking. So I have to cut that ear clamp off and change that. But back here, this pool of coolant is a little concerning. So I have to investigate. I'm going to investigate this before I do anything. Okay, so what I ended up doing on this connection, and I don't love it, and I'm not proud of it, but I put a normal worm gear hose clamp behind the ear clamp. And the reason I made the decision to Band-Aid this is if I cut that ear clamp off, it's a tight area to work in, and there's no question that I'm gonna be dumping coolant out from the head pressure. So the system is essentially full right now. And to replace that ear clamp would mean I gotta dump the system again. And I'm hoping not to do that at this point. Something I can do over the winter, no problem, but I just did dump the system. I really wanna do it a second time. So I put that second clamp on and we'll pressure test it and see if that solves the problem. Again, it is a Band-Aid. I don't love it, but right now it is what it is. On this side, what I did is I actually put a band clamp around here just to hold it while I messed with this clamp, because as soon as I started loosening this, the head pressure, this thing was leaking like a sieve. So what I did is I just repositioned this clamp, hopefully reseating it. We'll seal it because there's really nothing wrong with this clamp. Now, the one thing I don't love about these constant tension clamps is you see you've got a real nice wide band, but on the other side of the tang, you do not. It goes to a thinner band. And you'll also notice, I mean, this is part of the casting, but
I question now the integrity of the machine nipple on the other side. And when I had this, you know, apart, perhaps I should have hit that with a little bit of emery cloth and sanded a little bit more.
So here I use the endoscope to do some under expansion tank inspection of the clamps that I did yesterday. And you can see the clamps look well seated. The hoses are squeezed very well. And there is no leaking going on here. That is the larger hose under the expansion tank that I do have a constant tension on, and that one is not does not appear to be leaking anyway. So I just went through this just to take a look and see that this is okay. And it does appear to be decent.
Hey Jay, I know earlier I made a comment about the turbos, but frankly, you know, I don't even really know what they look like. And I actually think these are the turbos here. One here, of course, one on the other side, those boxes. And yes, there are lines that feed them. I didn't trace those lines, so I'm not exactly sure what they are. I suspect that they're coolant lines, but I don't know that completely.
Well, the curiosity is killing me, so I came out here and I see drips. And I saw I lost about maybe a quarter PSI in a little bit of time. So let's take a look at our suspects. So that looks good, no problem there. And that looks good, no problem there, no drips. Well, why do I have a drip here? And this was wet here earlier, and you can see, yep, it's wet. So where the hell is this damn thing dripping from? Earlier today when I saw some of this, I thought it was residual. Clearly it's not. So it looks like I have three leaks. So I'm not sure where that's coming from. I gotta believe it's coming from somewhere above, or it's transferring from this hose. Sorry for the bad camera footage. The hose feels dry to me. But there's something in here that's wet. Of course, I have a pool of coolant in here, so is this just wet from before, residual? Could be. Oh yeah, there's quite a bit of coolant in there. So that could be residual. This line is like a power line, so it's not coolant. So before I go to bed here, I'm gonna clean this up real good and see what's going on there.
Okay, so just raised up the car. And this is what we got, a leak on two different sides. So let me look at the stuff I fixed yesterday. So that's good. And that's good, there's no dripping there. So let me just double check that. Double check this. Yep, so what do we got cooking now? Well, it's coming from here, so it's landing on this pan and dripping. So that really could be one drip. Yeah, if I line that up on the floor, it lines up right with this pan. So it's obviously coming from above somewhere. Now I need to find out where it's dripping to get to the pan. So let's see if the pan's all wet. Well, the edge of the pan is wet. Can't look up in there. So yeah, it's traveling somewhere. So now the question is where? Where is it traveling from? This all looks good here, so I wouldn't think it's the radiator, but this one isn't going to be so obvious now. I got to find where that's wicking from. Stay tuned. I found what I believe is the leak. I don't know if it's the only leak, but it is definitely another one. Let me see if I can show this to you here. Okay. That connection right there is what it is, I believe. I'm able to turn the clamp. I don't know if I can do that with the camera on here and me videoing this. I just did it a second ago. Let's see. Okay, I got my finger on it here and the endoscope in here. And I'm kind of too zoomed in, but see it? See how I'm turning that hose? And see how it's wet when I do that? So that's another one right there.
Drove the car a bunch yesterday, no drips underneath. Level is exactly where it was. Woohoo! Hey guys, so it is Sunday, August 26th, and I believe we finally have success with the McLaren coolant leak saga. So if you've made it this far in the video and haven't killed yourself yet with such a long video, here's the summary. So I replaced 8 leaking hoses. Passenger side radiator, the top two. I did replace more hoses, but let me tell you what was leaking. Passenger side radiator, top two. Driver side radiator, lower main hose. Under the expansion tank, 3 of the small hoses leaking. Then a short tube from the expansion to an aluminum tube on the frame rail was leaking. And another one on the driver's side near the water pump, a smaller hose up above, you'll see it in the video. I forget which one that is. So I did those, and then I did the hose, lower radiator hoses at the engine block as well. And of course the lower hose on the passenger side. There might be one or two others that were real easy that I did that weren't leaking. So I drove the car Friday night, about 20 miles. Drove it yesterday, Saturday, 80 miles maybe, thereabouts. And checked, looked for drips, and checked the overflow tank. The lever was exactly where I left it. So I'm gonna call it a win for now. It doesn't mean that something else isn't gonna come up. But there you go, a lot of work, and she's ready to go. Thanks for watching, if you got this far. Have a great day.